It's at Husky Stadium on the Flubber, the wet Flubber. Doug Flutie starting for the Bills. Ricky running waters in the Seahawks. Bills, Seahawks, Flubber. Saturday night, Sunday night football.
I love you, Dolphin fans. Thank you.
And caught by Jumbo Elliott. He did what?
And the curtain that falls on Three River Stadium today is naturally a steel curtain.
And then he laterals it back to King.
Culpepper takes off. McNabb to the end zone for a touchdown.
Touchdown Raiders! He's gonna walk into the end zone.
This team is going to the playoffs.
Hand it back to Dillon, who breaks it all. 35-30. Corey Dillon!
He just broke his own record.
Terrell Owens. Touchdown.
Carter. Touchdown. What a way to do it.
I think it's time for me to go. San Francisco, I always love you guys.
Seattle, Washington, on the eve of Christmas Eve, and the city is adorned in its best holiday fare. A quick sleigh ride away from downtown is Husky Stadium on the campus of the University of Washington, where tonight the Buffalo Bills and the Seattle Seahawks say farewell to the 2000 season. Good evening, everybody. I'm Mike Patrick. It's great to have you with us. Merry Christmas and happy holidays from Seattle, Washington. Both of these teams were in the playoffs last season and started this year optimistically. Only a month ago, the Bills were 7-4. Now they're trying to avoid a five-game losing streak. The Seahawks have played better lately, but they're still 6-9 thanks to an atrocious defense, which is dead last in the NFL. Paul and Joe, it was two nights before Christmas, they said with a moan, "We both missed the playoffs, and we have to stay home."
And Michael, tonight we'll find out who has a passion to play, and the two guys that come to my mind are Doug Flutie and Ricky Waters. Doug Flutie, I don't care what the situation is, Joe, he brings excitement to the game, and the guy's a winner.
And you know what makes him so exciting? His ability to improvise. He throws the ball overhand, underhand, pushes it out, does anything he can to get the ball down the field. The other thing is, he can beat you with his legs just as easily. The Seahawks call him the wild card in this game. They better be ready to deal with that wild card.
Well, if he's the wild card, then I'm going to tell you, Ricky Waters is a jack of all trades. He's probably the most unpublicized star in the National Football League. Not only can he run with the ball, but he also is an excellent pass receiver. And Joe, he's done something that no other back has ever done in the history of the National Football League. For 7 years, he's gained over 1,500 yards from the line of scrimmage.
And the Seahawks went out and drafted a running back, Sean Alexander, number one, to take his job away. You said the numbers. He wasn't going to have any part of it. He's had an unbelievable year. When I had a chance to talk to him, he told me it was the best year he felt like he ever had. And Michael, if you're looking at a game that really doesn't have any meaning and nobody's going to a championship here, the one thing we're going to see out of this ball game, Doug Flutie, Ricky Waters, championship efforts.
Thank you guys. The win tonight will make the holidays a little brighter for one of these teams. The Bills and the Seahawks are next. In, log on and speak out. It's Enhanced TV, the online complement to tonight's broadcast. Log on to NFL.com now and click the Enhanced TV logo. Before the kickoff, let's go down to the sideline. Our colleague Solomon Wilcots with Seattle head coach Mike Holmgren.
Thanks, Mike. Coach Holmgren, you now have been coaching in the National Football League for 15 years, a head coach since 1992, but this is your very first losing season. How have you managed to deal with it?
Well, you know what? The league's been good to me, and I've had a great run. But it makes you stronger. I learned a lot of things about myself this season that hopefully make me a better football coach and a better manager of the organization next year.
Now, you have won four of your last six ball games, but you said your players are playing for something other than the playoffs at this point. What is that something else?
Well, I think you have to. I think in this business, it's a competition every play between me and the guy across from me. And the players have to understand that it can't be just for the money. It can't be just for the playoffs. I'm real proud of how they're playing.
Well said. Good luck tonight, Coach.
Thank you.
Well, tonight's stocking stuffer is a matchup between Seattle and Buffalo, so look out for getting ready to deck the halls.
ESPN welcomes you to the following presentation of the National Football League.
We're in Seattle where it's 41 degrees. Thankfully, no colder than that. The wind southeast 7 miles an hour, and we are expecting light rain throughout the evening. Steve Christie will kick it away for the Buffalo Bills. Has only one touchback this year. Not all Christie's fault. The plan has been with pooch kicks to the sidelines and in the middle of the field. And there's the dangerous Charlie Rogers, who has set 6 return records for the Seahawks this year. And the Bills' special teams have been dreadful on the whole. Rogers across the 20 with blocking. Pushed out of bounds at the 45-yard line, a return of 38. Let's look at the Seattle offense.
Hi, I'm Pete Kendall, the left guard. Tonight, our quarterback will be John, American History X, Kitna. Our running back will be Ricky Waters. Joining him in the backfield, the fullback, Mac Strong. At receiver, Sean Dawkins and Derek Mays, and the tight end will be Christian Fourier. Joining me up front, our left tackle will be Walter Jones. Our right tackle will be our rookie from Wisconsin, Chris McIntosh. Our right guard will be the little guy, Floyd Wedderburn, and the center is Chris Gray.
Kitna to throw on first down, incomplete to Christian Fourier. Let's look at that Buffalo defense.
Hi, I'm Marcel Vernon Wiley, defensive end from Columbia. The linemen are Sean Price, Ted Mount Washington, Corey Moore. At the linebackers, Jay Foreman, John Holasek, and Keith Newman gets busy most beautifully. And secondary, Chris Watson, Kenny Irvin, Henry and Mrs. Jones, and Tavares Tillman.
Marcellus, thank you very much. Ricky Waters on the ground across midfield, just in the Buffalo territory where Keith Newman makes the tackle.
Come here.
John Kitna probably was the last guy on earth that wanted to hear Mike Holmgren say, all we're going to be with John Kitna at quarterback is 8-8. That pretty much says it all, doesn't it?
Well, you know, last year 9-7. This year, if they win it 7-9, I mean, he has struggled through his entire 2 years here.
They wanted to have Brock Huard in there, but he's been hurt a couple of different times. Really having a good, have not had a good look at Huard. Waters in the flat, knocked out of bounds just shy of the first down marker. Solid tackle by Chris Watson. He's been a bonus for Buffalo. They signed him as a return guy. Turns out to be a corner that they really need.
Well, they got so many guys hurt in that secondary that Watson had to step up and play corner, and they have not been disappointed.
So Feagles will come on to punt. And Peerless Price waits inside his 10-yard line. So 3-and-out for Seattle on its first possession. Feagles, beautiful hang. Price up to the 12 for the fair catch. Let's meet the Buffalo offense.
I'm Doug Flutie, and joining me on offense, running back Sean Bryson, fullback Sheldon Jackson, wide receiver Eric Molds, all pro again, Peerless Price on the other side, Jay at tight end, just Jay because I mispronounced his last name, and John Keenan, Marcus Briggs at tackles, Ruben Brown and Jamie Nails at guards, and Jerry Ostrowski at center.
Doug, that's one way to get away with it.
I'll tell you, we were watching him yesterday trying to do that, and he just could not get Reamer's mind out.
Took me 3 years to get it right.
<That's> right. I can appreciate what Doug's doing.
And as you saw from the sign, the Bills do have some fans out here in Seattle. Flutie wants to throw first down. Price can't get it. Excellent coverage by the Seahawks. Sean Springs was the guy who got a hand on it, but he had a lot of help back there.
Come out with a little play action to start the game. Everybody talks about Doug Flutie. He can't throw the ball down the field. The outside receiver, Peerless Price, really slows down. Even he's not sure how far Doug can throw the ball. If he just keeps running, he's got a chance to split the two defenders.
Second and 10 with Bryson, the setback. Bryson gets the carry. Big hole. Seattle has given up large amounts on defense. Let's take a look at that Seattle defense.
Hi, I'm defensive end Michael Sinclair. And joining me on the defensive front is Matt LeBounty, Riddick Hurt Ankle Parker, Cortez Bobo Kennedy. The linebackers include Anthony Simmons, George Koontz, and Chad Snakeman Brown. The secondary, Sean Springs, Willie Williams, Kerry Joseph, and Jay Bellamy.
These lineups are a great opportunity for these guys to bust each other's chops. Third and two. Blitz coming. Bryson hit in the hole by Bellamy. Jay Bellamy, the strong safety, came up and drilled it.
Boy, this is what you really have to do. You get the Buffalo Bills are spread out, and they just send too many people. And Jay Bellamy, just, you'll see him on the left-hand side of your screen. Look at this. There's absolutely nobody left to block him, and he makes the tackle on Sean Bryson.
There is a flag down on the play.
It's again Seattle.
Ron Blum makes the call, and this will be a first down for the Bills.
Personal foul, unnecessary roughness, number 27 defense, 15 yards.
Willie Williams, the corner.
I think it's against Peerless Price. Number 27 is the outside defensive back. There you see Price and Williams locked up. There's the first swing that Price takes. Now here comes the retaliation. Well,
Come on. That is a shame when you commit a foul and the retaliator is always the guy who seems to be caught.
But that wasn't even retaliation.
Not much.
That push wouldn't even start a fight.
Flutie, short set, goes back the other side. And has the completion up across the 41 to Price, and Price and Williams are nose to nose again.
I want to bring out a point about Doug Flutie. Everybody says he's so diminutive in size that it's very difficult for him to operate out of a pocket. There was a case where he didn't have the receiver on the left side, stayed right in the pocket, turned and fired the ball out to the right. Doug Flutie can do everything you need to do to win at the quarterback position.
If you give him lanes to throw in.
If you give any quarterback lanes to throw in, including Rob Johnson.
Exactly.
Second and a yard. Fake the end around and give it to Bryson. He tries to stretch it out, and he'll lose yardage. Rob Johnson, who you saw earlier on the sideline, here they go again. More pushing and shoving. Chad Brown involved this time. Flags everywhere.
And Carl Mock didn't like it either. He's going to come over and protect his guys. Hey, I'll tell you one guy you don't want to... Chad does not want to take on Carl Mock.
No, sir.
Foul, unnecessary roughness, number 94 defense, pulling off the helmet, 15 yards, first down.
Well, this has gotten ugly early.
Well, the first call on Willie Williams was just a little shove. This one here certainly deserves the attention that the officials have given it. And Mike Holman just doesn't tolerate that.
No, he better settle his football team down because they're going to penalize him all the way to the goal line.
Well, Chad Brown, Joe, you're right. He got his money's worth on that one.
Well, you know, I mean, things, officials are going to call certain things out there. And just pulling the helmet, I mean, Mike is not happy with what he has seen.
Another first down for the Bills. Flutie changing the play. And now he's got to use the timeout. A small, boisterous crowd giving him as much problem as they can. We've got a timeout, back in a moment. These overhead shots of downtown Seattle provided by the Southwest Airlines Aerial Cam. One of the prettiest downtowns anywhere in America. Just gorgeous. We've been out here four or five times just before Christmas, and it is delightful.
Yeah, it's rained every time we've been out here.
Wade Phillips, who had a lot more optimism about this season than it turned out with a four-game current losing streak. Blitz coming on Flutie. And complete down to the 15 to Price. There's a flag down anyway. He was interfered with by Willie Williams. It looked like a couple of times before he caught it.
But what a great effort by Peerless Price. So often when a receiver gets interfered with, the first thing they... on, you see him grab their hip and say, give me a flag, give me a flag. Peerless Price
And defense, the penalties declined. First down.
Boy, you take a look at this. Now, we're looking at Willie Williams, number 27 on Peerless Price. Take a look at this. Watch where the throw is. There's the interference, and there is pass interference, but a great catch.
Look at the effort after. The thing about it is he didn't stop working even though the interference occurred.
Three penalties on this drive. That one, of course, was turned down. Flutie with a screen. Bryson. Touchdown. What an effort by Bryson.
You want to talk about sacrificing your body. He came up limping, Sean Bryson. But he got to about the two-yard line, and he realized he didn't have another blocker left in front of him. This was a screen pass to the outside, a perfect call. Here comes Bryson, number 38. But watch when he gets to about the two-yard line. He already ran out of blockers, and up in the air he goes. Jerry Ostrowski, the center, got an excellent block. Look at this effort, folks.
Kerry Joseph lowered his head, and Bryson went right over it. Christie with the point after, and the Bills, aided by some big penalty calls, go up 7-0. Was after Williams and Brown because of the penalties they committed on that drive that helped Buffalo get the go-ahead touchdown.
You notice, Joe, that neither guy said a word. You listened to Holmgren.
And while Chad Brown's was more graphic, but Willie Williams was the one that really hurt because that was a stop forcing Buffalo to possibly punt.
Rodgers on the return. Another good one across the 40 to the 41-yard line. We've got a great college bowl game for you next Saturday night at 8 Eastern. Eric Crouch in Nebraska meet Damian Anderson and Northwestern in the Sylvania Alamo Bowl from San Antonio. Crouch with that great option attack out there at Nebraska. Buffalo up 7-0 on Seattle. Seahawks with the ball for the second time. Getting the throw on first down. And throws complete. Sean Dawkins at midfield. Dawkins makes his 62nd catch. Let's go to Solomon Wilcott. Solly?
Yeah, Mike, we saw Mike Holmgren stop Chad Brown and Willie Williams. He talked to him. Well, they both came over and sat down on the bench. Holmgren then walked by. He was walking by, and he stopped. He gave him a nice long stare, and then he just turned and walked away. Sometimes the look is worth 1,000 words, you know?
Well, Solomon, he got the 1,000 words in first, then he gave him the look. Waters lowers his head, gets down to the Buffalo 47-yard line. Paul, here's what you mentioned in the open. 7 consecutive seasons, over 1,500 yards from scrimmage. No other player in the history of this league did that. Walter Payton did it 6 times. It's just a remarkable achievement for a guy that you don't think of as a Hall of Famer, but those numbers say it. Waters.
Here's the guy you're talking about, Ricky Waters. I mean, he can find a hole, he gets to the hole, and he's got enough power to break the tackle. He gets excellent blocking. Wedderburn, number 69 to 75, McIntosh on the right-hand side. But take a look at the blocking. And an outstanding block by Max Strong, who's a fullback coming up in the middle. There's that block. And then watch Ricky Waters just slip in. Henry Jones finally makes the tackle, but that's first down.
Best kept secret in the National Football League this year is Ricky Waters.
Waters over 1,000 yards with 3 different teams. Kitna throws underneath, and that one goes right through the rookie's hands, Daryl Jackson.
Now, he'll do that. I watched practice 2 days this week, and he had in each practice, the ball will slip through his hands. But I'll guarantee you this, somewhere in the course of this football game, you will see this young man make an exceptional catch. I think when it gets real easy for him, he loses a bit of focus.
Mike Holmgren, very big on Jackson and very big on the offensive line Paul was talking about just a moment ago. He wants to keep that offensive line together. They'll need to send Pete Kendall to do that. On the run, quickly out to the flat, complete to Derek Mays, who Holmgren got in trade from Green Bay, had him up there.
You know, Holmgren is very enthusiastic about this football team, but Joe, the one thing you talked about at the beginning, and they're going to go get a quarterback, and he made absolutely no bones about it. We need a quarterback.
Well, when you look around at this style of offense, people like Oakland, Philadelphia, Green Bay, San Francisco. All four of their quarterbacks are either MVP candidates or Pro Bowlers, and John Kitna hasn't played to that level. That's the only way this offense can be effective.
Third and eight, four-man rush.
Kitna complete. Touchdown, Darryl Jackson. There is a flag down.
This may come back for holding.
It's tripping. They're going to call tripping on Seattle's offensive line. Quit dancing, Darryl. You got to go back and run another play.
Tripping, 75 offense, 10 yards, repeat third down.
This is their rookie offensive lineman.
Chris McIntosh, number 75. You see him left lower part of your screen. Just Sean Price just comes in and tries to leg whip him, and they wind up with the penalty.
Man, the perfect throw, the great catch. You were just talking about Darryl Jackson.
Yeah. I'll tell you, he's like a little girl with the curl. He comes out, he can look so good, and sometimes you just think, how'd you drop that?
Well, he didn't drop that one. Now third and long. Tipped the line of scrimmage. Ricky Waters was wide open down the middle.
They had him on Jay Foreman, Joe, and he was wide.
This one was going to the house. I think Ricky Waters would have taken this one all the way. What an excellent call by Mike Holmgren. Now look at the middle of the football field. This ball just gets tipped ever so slightly by Leif Larson. Look at the field. Look at the middle of the football field. That's what Ricky was looking at. Oh, he can't believe it.
Fearless Price goes back to take the punt from Fegels. So Seattle had a touchdown called back by a penalty, and Fegels goes down, and that's going to be a penalty against the Bills.
And this is not a five-yard penalty either. This is knocking the kicker down. This will be a first down. This is called roughing.
And it was Kenyatta Wright, number 98, a backup linebacker, who just ran right up the middle and into Fegels. Ron Blum sorting it out with his.
Running into the kicker. Penalties declined. Timeout.
They declined the penalty because it's only the five-yard version.
You always protect kickers, don't you?
And it would not be an automatic first down. Timeout, 7-0, Bills. Doug Flutie and Rob Johnson, who have battled each other for 3 years for the quarterback job. Flutie has it right now because Rob Johnson injured again. They refuse to say it's a concussion, but he's not playing because he has headaches. It's a little difficult to tell the difference. Antoine Smith in as the running back. They fake it to him, and Billy down the sideline, incomplete, intended for Molds. Springs with the coverage. Take a look at the numbers that Flutie and Johnson have put up in the 3 years. Flutie with the much better record as a starter, 20-9. The points per game, very close. The sacks, a tremendous disparity between the number of times that Rob Johnson has sacked and Doug Flutie.
And he's 3-1 this year, and Rob Johnson, by the way, in this game, is the third quarterback.
Smith with a carry, hit at the line, flags are down as well. And it was Anthony Simmons, the left linebacker, who made the stop. Simmons played in the middle a year ago, did not play all that well. They moved him back to the outside after getting George Koontz, and he has played very well the outside linebacker spot.
Holding, 60 offense. Penalties declined, third down.
Jerry Ostrowski called for the hold.
When you look at the numbers comparing Flutie and Johnson, you think to yourself, well, next year there might be open competition because Doug has posted so many more wins. He doesn't feel that way, nor do I. I think Doug Flutie winds up going in next year as the number two, and Rob Johnson will probably go in as the starter again.
Third and nine. Flutie with good time. Reimers, though, with a catch. So the tight end who
There's
last that, name Doug can't pronounce.
That J guy.
Bails him out.
Well, he got the coverage he wanted on Anthony Simmons, number 51, the linebacker, and Riemersma was matched up. Doug Flutie just throws it to the outside. Simmons has really no chance at this ball. This is a perfect throw.
Sure, through one of those lanes you talk about.
One of those lanes you talk about. Yeah, that's right. And look at this, but a little bit behind Riemersma, but he's such a big target. And Flutie on third down loves to throw to this guy, so Jay Riemersma.
So picky, threw it a little bit behind.
Flutie to throw again. Price is ripped by Bellamy. Bellamy, a free agent out of Rutgers, has been in the league for 7 years. A lot of free agents don't last because coaches want to replace them with high draft choices, but this guy's always been able to play.
He has, and one of the things also about Doug Flutie tonight, you'll see he's wearing a glove. He's actually wearing two gloves. I talked to him on the field before the game, and he said, I'm going to go with gloves. They allow him to get a better grip on the ball so that if he has to step back and fire, he feels like he can put a little more zip on it.
Gain of only four on the last completion, second and six. Smith bowls his way across the 40 to about the 42. Koontz was in on the stop. Antoine Smith, 2 years ago, gained over 1,100 yards and has been virtually invisible in this offense this season.
This year, 84 carries only. 84 carries. You see just 207 yards, averaging 2.5 yards a carry.
And if Sammy Morris were healthy tonight, Antoine Smith would not be back there.
They've used Bryson and Morris for the most part in the second half of the season. Flutie. Flag down. Complete to the sideline. They say he was shoved out of bounds. The catch made by Jeremy McDaniel. Now we'll check the marker. And it's holding on Seattle. The Seahawks continue to kill
four
themselves.
Four defense. Penalties declined.
Jeremy McDaniel is one of those guys that has stepped up really big for this offense. One of the young guys, 41 catches, working right across the field. Now he just, watch what he does by the sidelines. He knows where he is, stops, sets himself, does a good job of getting his feet down and giving Doug a target.
Double wing formation. Smith hit in the backfield by Simmons and then finished off by Joseph. Be sure to be with ESPN Christmas Day at 2:30 p.m. Eastern for part one of the season, a documentary on the North Penn Knights, a high school football team in Pennsylvania, and their quest to become state champions. I am told that is a wonderful show. We invite you to tune in for that. Second and 10 for Buffalo. Bills already leading 7-0 first quarter. Four wide receivers for Flutie. Blitz coming. Throw sideline and caught by Moles.
Oh, my.
What a throw.
Well, you want to know, you're going to see right now why this guy is going to the Pro Bowl. And he is, in my opinion, still is, I think, right now, one of the best receivers in the National Football League, if not the best.
And he has just set a single-season record with his 91st catch, breaking a tie with Andre Reed.
If you ever caught a football in your life, you'll know how difficult this catch is because you really lose sight of the ball when it comes over your helmet.
But what wins it is the release off the line. Now, Sean Springs is a pretty darn good corner, and Eric Moles went by him with his physical strength like he wasn't there.
Flutie with time. Price!
Touchdown.
Touchdown! Sean Price caught it at the goal line and fought his way across the stripe.
Well, it doesn't look like the Buffalo Bills are having any problem with the footing on this field. That's Willie Williams. They've been locked up before. This time, he tries to go up top, then slides on underneath, does a nice job of being patient and holding a spot for Doug to be able to fire. Look at him look away. I love to watch Doug Flutie play football.
As for Peerless Price, his third touchdown catch of the year. Flutie, 8 out of 10 tonight. Already 131 yards and 2 touchdowns. Bills. go 84 yards behind Doug Flutie in 4 minutes and 17 seconds and now have a 14-0 lead over the Seahawks. That defense has been shredded all year, and it looks like they're going to go out the way they played the first 15 games. There's Charlie Rogers. Had two very nice kick returns.
High short pooch kick. Rogers again. Another big return.
Goodbye.
Charlie Rogers, see you later. Touchdown Rogers. 81 yards. Charlie Rogers, great return man. See a seam, hit it, and go. And what he does on this play, watch this. He sees the middle now, and now he explodes. There are no more breaks. He's gone.
That's Ronnie Jones, the special teams coach. He has lived the nightmare. He replaced Bruce DeHaven because of the Music City Miracle. Well, they said that wasn't the reason why, but it just happened to occur coincidentally after they lost in the first round last week in the playoffs. And Ronnie Jones has been the recipient of some very unfortunate luck.
14-7, the Bills lead in 15 seconds, cut in half. Special teams has been the story all year, a very negative story for the Bills and a very good one for Charlie Rogers. The Bills special teams now headed by Ronnie Jones. Bruce DeHaven fired, as Joe said, after the Music City Miracle last year. But it's only gotten worse for Buffalo special teams. Punt returns, kickoff returns, net punting, and the opposition start after kickoffs all dead last. Jonathan Linton to return for Buffalo.
Now, I will say this. The special teams are comprised of a lot of young players, 10 new players, most of them playing on special teams. I want you to focus on Chris Watson, number 21 of the Buffalo Bills. I'm going to spot him for you right there. See him right there? Watch what he does. He's going to go over here. He's not even looking at Charlie Rogers. He'll go over and take on the block of Kerry Joseph, number 21. Instead of looking for the ball carrier, he went over and ran into a blocker.
Buffalo starts from its own 37. Flutie to throw. Excellent protection. Deep down the middle. Caught by Bowles. Complete out. Sean Springs was all over him. He caught it anyway.
Sean Springs really played the ball. This is as good a defensive play as you can make as a corner. Sean Springs is running man for man with Eric Bowles. And you'll watch him now. He's going to play the ball. He looks back at the ball. He sees it. He goes up at the same time. Now you see how strong Moles is. Look at this. He just takes the ball away between his arms.
You know what else I like? I'm going to give the officials some credit right here. They let two guys go up and have hands on one another and go for the play. We throw the term great around, I think, a little too much in this league. Not in the case of Eric Moles. He is great.
Flutie, look out behind, completes one inside the 10 under a lot of pressure. Peerless Price makes that catch. Flutie has been magnificent so far, but one of the hallmarks of Seattle's defense has been giving up huge plays all year long, a lot of yards and a lot of points.
14 of them over 40 yards coming in, and now it's 15. Steve Sidwell is the new defensive coordinator.
And it's not really the coordinator's fault. We're going to need some new players. Mike Homer doesn't think they're very strong up the middle. Smith still on his feet. Touchdown.
And they don't tackle very well either.
Certainly not on that one.
Well, I'll tell you, this is something they've been looking for out of Antoine Smith since he came to the Buffalo Bills. The fact that he can make a cut, get back, and then break tackles to get in, not in the end zone, but to pick up extra yardage. This is something he has really not been doing.
He beat two of the Seahawks' best that time, Chad Brown and Jay Bellamy. Christie knocks it through. 21-7 Buffalo, an offensive explosion.
All right, here's Antoine Smith. Now watch this. There's Brown, 94. Bellamy is 20. We saw him make a great tackle a little while ago. And Antoine Smith just keeps his feet, keeps his head up. And look at it. Here shows you the power in his legs. Watch his legs just do not stop.
For some people, you would think this game doesn't mean anything. It means something to these guys. They want to finish 500. They want to go out on a good note.
The only unfortunate part about it is now they have to kick off to him again.
Yeah.
That has been a problem.
Yep. Well, look at it this way. It gives Charlie Rogers a chance to possibly, on the last game of the season for the Seahawks, set an incredible record for special teams yards.
He already has 150 yards on kickoff returns in three tries.
Well, Tyrone Hughes has 304, so let's keep that number out there as the record to shoot for.
Well, he could cut it by 90 again on this one. Will Christie kick it short or deep? This time he'll squib one.
Let Charlie have it.
That'll got it.
Rogers from the 13. That's his worst return so far. Only got it out to the 34-yard line. ESPN Saturday Night Football is brought to you by Quick and Riley, a Fleet Boston Financial Company. By Hewlett-Packard, inventing new ways to live and work. By Southwestern Bell, a member of the SBC Global Network, and by Toyota. More choices, better selection. Experience Toyota today.
And a happy new year. We wish you a Merry Christmas. We wish
you. I love this time of the year. Are you kidding?
Apparently.
I like this stadium.
No,
we're really
don't.
In
no,
the
you
elements.
Don't. No, you don't.
Kittner with all the time in the world to throw. Dawkins can't get there.
John Kitna has really gotten back the quarterback position. You see the yards they posted, minimally 33, only because Brock Heward got hurt. Mike Holmgren wanted to take a good hard look at Brock Heward, thought he had a chance maybe to be his quarterback, wound up getting hurt, and the job fell back into John Kitna's hands. And now they'll have to evaluate. Mike says, hey, look, I didn't know much about Brock in the beginning to evaluate him. Here we've gone through another year, and I really don't know much more about him at all.
Ricky Waters slithers up to the 38-yard line, and Ricky Waters now 12th all-time on the NFL rushing list, past Otis Anderson in the first quarter.
Here's how to write in the rain, Joe. You can learn it, you know.
I don't want to be in the rain to write.
But one of the things that Mike Holmgren is really, really happy about is that offensive line of his. He's got a great offensive line, as you said. If they can re-sign Pete Kendall, they're going to be solid up front.
Getting to the throw on third down. Wide open over the middle, hands the first down at the Buffalo 47.
I just want to make a point about John Kitna. You saw him hang in the pocket, and that's admirable. But I think what Mike Holmgren is looking for is he is looking for a quarterback who doesn't have to sit in the pocket all the time. Somebody who can break out and make a play with his legs. You know, and you got to realize he's been spoiled. You look at the three guys he's had, Montana, Young, and Brett Favre. You know, I don't know if you were looking for something like that. It may take a little while.
Waters for the 45. The shame is Brock Heward may not get another chance if Mike goes out and gets a high-profile quarterback to be a starter. End of the quarter, 21-7 Buffalo.
Breaks it all, baby! 35-30, Corey Dillon!
He just broke his own record.
Terrell Owens, touchdown!
Carter, touchdown! What a way to do it!
I think it's time for me to go. San Francisco, I always love you guys.
Some great moments in the 2000 season. We'll tell you about some that may come tomorrow. Just a second, Ricky Waters with the catch to the Buffalo 39-yard line, a couple yards shy of a first down. Going to see some records fall tomorrow in all likelihood. The fewest points allowed in the 16-game season. The record belonged to the 86 Bears. That incredible defense. The Ravens are crushing that record. The most passing yards in the season. The Rams only 15 away from breaking the 84 Dolphins record from Dan Marino. Most touchdowns in the season. Emmitt Smith with 25. Marshall Faulk, who has had 2 four-touchdown games this year, is 2 behind. Sean Alexander has checked in for the first time. Instead, they throw complete to Darryl Jackson. He's got a first down. Check it on Falk. He has four touchdown games this year.
I love talking to Darryl Jackson the other day, and Joseph, you know, how fast are you? And he's one of those guys, I'm as fast as I need to be. And he really is. Watch this. Look at his quick move to the inside. I mean, he catches the ball, holds onto it. That's just concentration. This young man's going to be a great player.
Leads all NFL rookies in catches, yards, and touchdowns. Waters, not much. Ricky down to the 27-yard line. Joe, there is not the future of the Seattle Seahawks as Ricky comes up limping. It's going to be Sean Alexander. And Ricky Waters is another guy. You wonder if there's any chance that he'll be back next year.
Well, I think if there's going to be a decision to make on this football team, that will be the most difficult. Obviously, they drafted Sean Alexander, number one, to be the man here. And I think he has a lot of great ability, good quickness. But I would think that Ricky's going to be a tough one to cut loose.
Alexander gets the carry. Number one draft choice out of Alabama, where he set the school records there. How good was he as a prep star? They retired his number in high school while he was still in high school.
And he has a street named after him already.
That's right. It's the one that leads up to the high school. Boone County High in Florence, Kentucky.
How often do you see a number one draft choice this good and only get 60 carries in the entire year? That tells you about Ricky Waters.
Doesn't it, though? Alexander again to the 20.
All right, what do you do now?
You go for it.
That's Nolan Cromwell, the wide receiver coach. I think Mike's got to go for it.
This is not a decision. Just go. Go.
Well, he's between a rock and a hard place. His defense hasn't shown him the ability to stop Buffalo at all.
Yeah, but they're inside the 20-yard line. Buffalo really hadn't slowed this team down. They've stopped themselves twice.
Fourth and less than a yard. Alexander takes it outside. To the 10. To the 3.
If there is one position that Sean Alexander has filled all year, he has been their short yardage back. And this is the reason why. He shows extreme patience for a young back. He starts to hit it up inside. Doesn't like the hole. But now has the quickness to turn the corner and the balance to stay inbounds.
It's a nice block by his fullback, Max Strong, that helped him get to the corner. First and goal, Waters back in there.
That's what really shows about this young man. He keeps his balance and comes back inside.
Waters! No signal yet. Just short of the goal line. John Holosek was the man who made the saving tackle. And Ricky is upset. He thought he had it.
Ricky Waters, this time he goes on his own up the middle. He goes lunging in. I got to think, you got to give Ricky another crack at this.
You may give him three more.
That's a great mark by the officials.
Yes, it is.
That ball was not in the end zone.
Second and goal. Movement up front, and that looked like it will cost Seattle 5 yards.
I don't know, guys. Could have been Buffalo.
Hitting is pointing at Buffalo. I love it when players go in and try to help him out. You know, Holosek goes in. Let me tell you what happened.
Kitten goes in.
That would have been the one that was ruled down at the one-inch line and still could be. Ricky Waters' 25th touchdown with Seattle. It would be his 25th touchdown or more with three different teams. Nobody's ever done that in the history of the NFL.
In the neutral zone.
Encroachment, defense, half the distance to the goal, repeat second down.
That will be a one-inch penalty.
You know what's bad about it, though, is if something would happen now, if Seattle goes in motion or something happens, it's 5 yards. They should only penalize them like a half.
That's why I don't believe as an offense when you get into this situation, you keep your linemen down very long. You go on a quick count, you let them get up, fire out, and go.
Waters again to the goal line. No Marchetti short again.
They've run him a couple times out of the eye. This time they try and put him in a halfback position and let him go laterally, and the penetration stops him. See where he is? He's over in the halfback, in the halfback position next to the fullback.
I'll tell you, the guy that gets penetration is number 93, Pat Williams. Watch Pat Williams get penetration right here. 93. He's the guy that grabs Ricky Waters right at the goal line.
Now you go play out.
Third and goal. Kittner just falls into the end zone. Everybody was looking for Waters or anything else, but a quarterback keeper, there was no resistance there at all. He could have walked in standing up.
John Kittner, you see him smiling coming up. Look at, they're all looking. Pat Williams just taken right down the middle. Chris Gray, the center, number 62. Watch this. What a block up front.
And Pete Kendall, number 66. Between Gray and Kendall, Kittner gives himself an opportunity to try and spike the ball.
Ryan Lindell, the rookie out of Washington State, for the point after. And the Seahawks have worked their way back into this ball game. Kittner gets the score on the sneak. It's a 7-point lead. Earlier to the quarterback battle that's been ongoing for 3 years between Doug Flutie and Rob Johnson, you wonder how long it can continue.
Well, the Buffalo Bills are totally disappointed in Rob Johnson, Joe, because of his inability to stay healthy. They just don't really know what they have.
And I just don't think that you go into next year and you anoint Rob Johnson the starter. I think Doug Flutie has earned the right to lead this football team to victories. If they come out and say Rob Johnson is our quarterback, I think it's a bad move by the Buffalo Bills. If you don't want to turn it into competition, then Doug Flutie's earned the right. Rob Johnson's going to have a lot of years to play. Doug Flutie's time is very limited, and the production that he puts out, in my opinion, should be the deciding factor.
But if Rob Johnson is the starter, will Doug Flutie get the chance to go somewhere else?
No, because of the economics.
Avion Black gets back to the 15 and no more. The economics of the situation, the cap number for Flutie is $7.75 million. For Rob Johnson, it's 8.2. Now, in the current state of affairs, you may not have to pay that salary if you cut somebody, but it comes back and hits you with the salary cap. So as far as the cap is concerned, it's virtually the same thing.
And the other thing too, Joe, is when you want to take the hit this year and let one of them go, and or do you want to wait another year?
That's a decision for Mr. Wilson to decide.
Antoine Smith, the running back, as the Bills start from the 15.
Flutie to throw under pressure, got out of it. Slides in at the 22. Let's go to Solomon Wilcox.
Yeah, Mike, Rob Johnson's frustration over the quarterback situation became even more public today in the Buffalo newspapers, where he was quoted as saying that he is ready to coexist with Doug Flutie going into next season, but it became clear that he'd rather not. He said that the public sentiment in Buffalo will always be on Doug Flutie's side, and he said that the booing of the fans in Buffalo has not only affected his play, but the play of his teammates as well. He concluded by saying that the team needs to make one decision on one quarterback and stick to it going into next season, Mike.
And Solomon, when you say coexist, it's sort of like the Russians and the United States coexisted during the Cold War.
Let me just say, I have a real problem with what Rob Johnson just said about coexisting, and it's going to be a problem. It is only a problem if you don't play to your potential. And Wade Phillips believed in Rob Johnson and said, you're my starter. He has not been able to live up to his abilities. So it isn't a problem for the fans. It isn't a problem for his teammates. Rob Johnson has to learn how to stay healthy. I believe he has the talent, but his biggest thing is staying on the field.
First down, Buffalo. Flutie the time. Throws behind Moles. He caught it again. Another remarkable grab.
Oh, I am so glad we're watching this show. For people who aren't watching this, are they missing something special? Eric Moles is the inside receiver. Again, Sean Springs has him everywhere. This ball is thrown low and inside. Watch where Flutie throws this.
I like what Flutie said about this guy with Moles. He says, I got a thing with Moles. I know where he's going to be. He knows I'm going to throw it short. He knows where the ball is going to be.
Moles, a premier free agent, and certainly it would be mandatory for Buffalo to re-sign him.
Smith. Nice stutter step and carries Bellamy with him into Seattle territory at the 47.
Seattle in this first half of the ball game, they're showing you why they're the worst defense in the National Football League. I mean, they just really cannot slow anybody down. And I'm not taking anything away from the Buffalo Bills offensive linemen blocking. It's just that this team, they just don't do anything.
After Mike Holmgren talked about going out and getting a quarterback, the next thing he said they need are some big defensive linemen. They're very small across the front four.
Says it's like baseball, he needs to be tougher up the middle. Smith again. Hitting the backfield that time and then gang tackled by the Seahawks. And you see, it's not a lack of effort. These are willing players under Mike Holmgren. There's just not a great deal of talent out there on that unit anymore. Most yards allowed per play in a season. The Seahawks, an incredible 6.18 yards a play. That would be the worst since the merger. Floating, naked bootleg, close in the flat, complete. And a big tackle out there again by Bellamy on the huge tight end Reimers.
Boy, they had the blitz on it. What they did is they forced Flutie to get rid of the ball right away. Brown was back in the backfield with him, Chad Brown. And when they hit Reimersma, Jay Bellamy was right there.
We showed you those numbers on the Seattle defense. They're finishing it with a flurry tonight. They're allowing 10 yards a play.
Whoops. Well, if you can, you always try and put a record out of reach.
Yeah. Well, they're working on it.
This is not the one of the records you want to put out of reach.
Second and nine for the Bills. Smith. Oh, look at the hole. Antoine Smith stopped again by Bellamy. Down to the 30. Reggie Tongue helped out on the tackle. But a gaping hole in that Seattle defense.
On the right-hand side of the offense, the left-hand side of the defensive line.
Well, when they get offensive double teams like Jamie Nails and Marcus Spriggs does, it makes it real easy. Look at the hole. Michael Sinclair goes up, and you get to see what Antoine Smith sees. Nothing but daylight.
And your eyes get to be about the size of saucers if you're a running back, and you see that hole. Flutie flushed out of the pocket. Lot of road, floating inside the 15-yard line.
I'll tell you what, what I love about Flutie is when he gets outside, because he can see the defensive backs are in man coverage and they're covering downfield, so they turn their backs on Flutie. Watch how quick he adjusts. All right, he's to the outside. Now watch him. He knows he's past the line of scrimmage and tuck it in. Everybody's looking back towards the goal line and towards the receivers. He just runs for like 20 yards.
Still got some speed, doesn't he?
He's got everything. You give him a chance to play a full season for somebody, he's a pro bowler. Look
well, at this out of 14 tonight. And Linton comes in at running back and clearly throws it to him on the screen, and Linton dropped the ball. One of the reasons Jonathan Linton has not seen a lot of action tonight, plays like that, only 30 carries, only 3 catches all season long.
Yeah, but one of them was for a touchdown. Pretty good percentage. Obviously not that one.
You're looking for the silver lining.
Always looking for that positive thing for Wade's team. Look for that positive. Look for that positive, Paul. Last game of the season.
What do we got up here, Nanook of the North? You got enough clothing on to be in Alaska.
You're right. I'm real close, too. I'm real close to it.
Look at this, folks.
Hey, how's it going? They're under the heat lamps, by the way.
Smith back in at running back. And around to Price. Price slips a couple of tackles, goes inside the 10. And if it hadn't have been for Michael Sinclair playing his position beautifully and slowing that down, it could have been a touchdown.
Yeah, but you want to talk about a guy in no man's land, it's Michael Sinclair. Michael Sinclair is out there, and what do? Here I am, I'm playing this perfectly. Here comes Peerless Price, and I can't catch him. But I can move him inside and hope that somebody else can come up and make the play, and they do. But this is really a sick feeling. Here he is, he's sitting out here, Michael Sinclair going, oh, no.
The anatomy of a mismatch. 4 wide receivers.
This is where you just got to be careful of Flutie with possibly a quarterback draw or running with the ball.
There he goes. And this time he couldn't escape Cortez Kennedy. The greatest, possibly the greatest player. I was going to say the best defensive lineman, possibly the greatest player that ever played for this franchise. An 8-time Pro Bowler.
Kez does a real nice job. You don't look at the coverage. He really doesn't have anywhere with to go with the ball. But what I like about Doug's decision here is no one is open. You can see that they're all covered. He decisively says, I'm just going to go. Nice job by Kez, just grabbing an ankle.
Christie comes on for a 26-yard field goal attempt.
Hooked it and hit the post.
What else can happen?
I don't know. We got a lot of time to find out. It's wonderful how we all get in such a better mood when it's Christmas time. Certainly that's the case for Paul and Joe. They've been sniping at me for 3 weeks now. Kitna trying to get rid of it on the screen to Waters, and he is dropped by Pat Williams, the big guy at 310 plus.
Pat Williams sniping away at John Kitna.
Oh, Pat Williams, you know, he backs up Ted Washington, and when he comes in, this guy seems to always make things happen. We saw him on a goal line stop Ricky Waters. This guy is a great football player, and there's a guy that can start anywhere in the National Football League.
Carsten Bailey and Darryl Jackson, two of the young receivers, check in for Seattle. And second and 10. Getting a short set, throws it behind Dawkins.
You really have to admire the job that the defensive coordinator of the Buffalo Bills has done, Ted Cottrell. He lost Keon Carpenter, Winfield, Greer, Coward, Rogers, and yet still manages to keep this defense in the top five.
And Hanson, their third overall in total defense in the NFL, number one a year ago, and yet when there's an opening for a head coaching job, you never hear the name mentioned of Ted Cottrell.
And Marcellus Wiley has done a good job stepping up for him also.
Wide open is the rookie, Darryl Jackson.
I tell you one thing, Darryl Jackson is quick. Once he gets his hands on the ball, here's a guy from Florida that really learned how to run patterns with Spurrier down here. But watch how quick he turns when he gets the ball. Bang, bang. Now he's already looking upfield just to pick up the extra yards to get the first down. This is an experienced rookie.
Getting it with a short set. Got him again. Lost the football. Darryl Jackson made the catch and then lost it, and the Bills recover. Ken Irvin knocked it away. Donovan Greer got it back. We have reached the two-minute warning at 1:58. It will be Buffalo football when we come back. Have Chris Berman in the Hyundai Halftime Show, our Sports Center in game segment. The Giants clinch home field and the playoff scenario.
How about them Giants?
How about that guarantee by Coach Fossil?
Just
congratulations,
amazing.
Jim, and your ball club.
We did the first game when he guaranteed it out in Arizona.
Oh, so now you're going to take credit?
No, I would take a little bit.
Okay.
An amazing job by Jim Fossil. Flutie. From the catch made by Cavill. Kwame Cavill got away from everybody. It's a gain of 40. One big play after another against that Seattle defense.
Well, they go into nickel coverage, which means Paul Miranda, number 22, is in. Now, he just cuts it loose. He thinks he has backup help, and the safety is not there. Look at this. That's why he's wearing the gloves. He can put a little more mustard on it and throw it down the field. Boy, at Doug Flutie, it's a shame he can't throw the ball, huh, Paul?
He could have thrown it 5 yards further and been a touchdown.
Smith gets to the six. The Seattle defense has already given up 8 plays of more than 15 yards tonight. That's the first half, and look at the numbers on Flutie. He has most of them. 13 out of 16, 244 and 2.
I like talking with him yesterday, Joe, because the very first thing he said was, we are going to throw the football.
Yeah, even though their rush defense isn't that good, they felt like the opportunities that they had in the air were better.
The Seahawks solidifying their position as the worst defense in the league. Flutie, Reimers, did he stay in? Yes!
Now, I'm just going to go out on a limb right now and say that without looking at any replays, this might be one to consider in review if you're Mike, if you're inclined to do that.
Okay, here comes your limb. Moody.
Nice.
Does
touch.
He get both feet inbounds? One drags that back foot.
Yes, sir.
That's a catch. That's a touchdown.
That's right.
Watch the back foot. The right foot is in. Watch him drag that back foot. He's got control of the ball. That, no question about that. That's easy.
The big tight end from Michigan gets his second scoring pass of the season. And the Bills trying to lay on the Seahawks. They're now up 28-14 with 1:09 to go first half. This offense really let down on that fourth possession. They only missed a field goal and hit the upright. The other four, they've gotten touchdowns.
So they weren't going to take a chance.
Squib kick taken by one of the up men and down at the 32-yard line. Reggie Brown comes up with the ball. And Buffalo being very careful to avoid the Seattle return game right now.
Cortez Kennedy's not very happy.
And you can't blame him. His stomach shook like a bowl full of jelly. Ho, ho, ho. Down at the mall, Santa Claus, I guess, telling the kids that they're all sold out of PlayStation 2.
Then he got on his sleigh and shot down here, and he's in the game.
Well, how do you think he visits all those homes in one night?
He's had that little bell since the beginning.
Kitna with good protection and rifles one up to the 41-yard line, complete to Derek Mays.
Remember, the Seahawks were moving the last time as well.
And they have all three timeouts to work with. Draw play to Waters.
Timeout.
To midfield. And Mike Holmgren signals his first timeout with 45 seconds to go. ESPN Saturday Night Football is brought to you by PlayStation 2. By Prudential, your rock-solid choice for insurance, investments, real estate, and financial services. And by the world's most popular ATVs, Honda, the best on earth. You guys aren't singing along with this one?
I don't know the words of this one. But I tell you what, did you see Mike Holmgren when Kitna called timeout? He said, come here. We'll talk to you.
John's walking.
Yeah, he's walking. The reason we called timeout, I want to talk to you. Now, get over here.
Now, these people are dedicated, coming out 2 days before Christmas, sitting in the cold and the rain to watch a team that's not going anywhere.
I love this guy, though. I think this guy's a great coach.
He's the best.
He is something.
He's very frustrated with his inability to turn it around immediately. Waters on the screen. He'll lose a couple.
Nice job defensively. Good job by Eric Flowers, number 96. He got out there first to stop that screen.
Under 30 seconds. Kitna underneath the Waters, and he dropped the ball. If you're having trouble figuring it all out, you can get the complete playoff picture on NFL.com. Yes, we are having trouble figuring it all out. Chris Berman, I'm sure, has an excellent explanation at halftime. He'll go over the entire playoff picture for you.
Of course, we'll be someplace next Saturday.
Someplace.
One of the wild cards. Early
or
late.
No idea where. Third and 12 for Kitna. Only 21 seconds to go. Throws. That one's dropped again, and it's just as well for Seattle. It wouldn't have gotten them enough, and it was in the middle of the field.
And they're going to punt the ball.
Well, you get the feeling Mike Holmgren figures with 15 seconds to go and only 55 yards to go, Buffalo's liable to score again. Fegels will come on, and Peerless Price will go back to take the punt. Eagles hit after he got it out of there. No flag. And he kills it inside the five. And the Seahawks being very smart. They're not going to touch it.
until the official forces them to and time runs out. That's the end of the first half. To score, the Bills 28, the Seahawks 14. Now let's join Chris Berman for SportsCenter in game, the Hyundai Halftime Show.
All right, Michael, thank you very much. Happy holiday to everybody out there, both out there in, as we say, TV land, and certainly in Seattle, in rainy Seattle, where do you think Doug Flutie can still be effective as a starting quarterback? The Bills lead the Seahawks 28-14. Do you think Jim Fossil's speeches and the way he's gone around his business as head coach of the Giants is effective? 5 games ago, he essentially threw down the gauntlet. Quiet in the locker room, go out and play football. 5 games later, the G-Men are the number one seed in the NFC playoffs. But they had to beat Jacksonville first. Fred Taylor did some talking this week, had a long touchdown run, but left injury with 52 yards. Kerry Collins to Ike Hilliard, then early fourth in a low-scoring game, 14-10 Giants. Later fourth, Kiki Barber, dragged down by Mike Logan, right ankle rolled on, sprained toe, right foot after Tiki got over 1,000 yards. So, low scoring, just over 3 minutes to go. Kerry Collins to well-dressed Amani Toomer. 54-yard touchdown. 193 yards today for Toomer, 21-10 Giants. Mark Brunell against the prevent defense. Scrambling, but a prevent defense is supposed to prevent this. Keenan McCardell between two Giants, 59-yard completion. 2 plays later, Brunell, Kyle Brady, touchdown, 2-point conversion, good, 21-18. All of a sudden, a scoring fest. Jags for the onside kick, but it's Jason Sehorn. He could go all the way, 28-18, Giants. Next Jag possession, under 25 seconds to go. Hold the phone, Brunell, Alvis Whitted. It's a 3-point game again, 28-25. Naturally, Sehorn is Johnny on the spot with the next onside kick, 28-25. G-Man, they'll be home throughout the playoffs.
I'm very proud of them. Very proud of them. There was, they have a tremendous amount of resolve. Got guys making plays, games on the line. Some guys were banged up the way they played. We're the number one team coming out of the NFC, and we're not the we're not a bona fide contender. I mean, that, what the hell is that all about? For us right now to finish with the number one seed in the NFC and get the bye is a tremendous advantage. We need to take advantage of that from that standpoint. This team knows. I mean, they were happy in that locker room, but they were also just anxious about, you know, we got to take care of business as we move forward.
Jim Fossil did it with his speaking 5 games ago, and the Giants did it on the field. They have earned the number one seed. If everybody wins tomorrow, who could? The Vikings, with Bubby Brister probably instead of Culpepper, would be the 2 seed. But the Bucs could still catch the Vikes in the NFC Central. The Saints may or may not get a bye depending on their game with the Rams. The Eagles could have a home game next week as a wild card team, could have a road game. If Detroit beats the Bears tomorrow, they're in. If Detroit loses, it opens up the doors for perhaps the Rams and perhaps the Packers, who host the Bucs. That's all we know in the NFC playoff picture right now, but we do know the road to the Super Bowl in the NFC goes through the Meadowlands.
This halftime show is presented by Hyundai. Every Hyundai is backed by America's best warranty with 10 years powertrain coverage.
41 years of Broncos football at Mile High came to a close. We'll be back.
SportsCenter in game. The Hyundai Halftime Show with your host, Chris Berman.
Buffalo Bills behind Doug Flutie, lead at Seattle. 4 Bills touchdowns, 28-14 at the half. Well, they began as an AFL team in 1960 playing in then Bears Stadium. Became Mile High Stadium in 1968, and they started building on stands. And then the Broncos became a good team with the Orange Crush defense. John Elway and the Broncos in the 80s and 90s. 5 times to the Super Bowl, of course, the 2 wins in the 90s. 41 years of Denver football came to a close today as the Broncos hosted the San Francisco 49ers. But it really wasn't just a celebration for Denver. It was a celebration for the entire Rocky Mountains. As fans of the Broncos from Colorado and Idaho and Utah and Wyoming and New Mexico. They're all there. And, oh, by the way, Jerry Rice, probably his last game as a 49er. So history all the way around. Uh-oh, just back from shoulder surgery. Brian Griese, hit by Princeton Buckner, left the game, came back briefly, but he could have continued. And uh-oh, Gus Frerotte, hit unpleasantly by Anthony Pleasant. But Frerotte came back. With John Elway have to play quarterback? Let's not go that far. Greasy came back in. Karen Coleman breaks loose. Well, they just breed running backs in Denver. 24 yards, 10-0 Broncos. Fourth and four Niners. Jeff Garcia to J.J. Stokes. And words during the week, hits on Saturday. Bill Romanowski, J.J. Stokes, renew acquaintances. With a score of 17-0 Broncos, on we go to the third. Gus Frerotte to Easy Ed McCaffrey. Touchdown, he had 101 catches. Rod Smith, 100, the first tandem to do that in the NFL since Detroit did it in 95. Jerry Rice caught 6 for 61. But in the end, it was Denver in a festive mood all over the Niners, 38-9.
We were gonna come out and we were gonna dominate this football team. And we're going to have 11 guys on every single play, giving it everything they got and playing for one another. And that's what we did. We were more intense than that football team, and it showed throughout the whole game. We wanted to play well tonight. We wanted to go into the playoffs feeling good, and that's the state we're in.
201st win at Mile High since it opened in 1960. That was Bill Romanowski with Andrea Kramer, and, of course, the Ring of Fame and the current Broncos shaking hands. It's a love affair in Denver between the Rocky Mountains and their Denver Broncos, as Mike Shanahan well knows.
If we do have a home game next week, I hope they bring those seats back, because I looked up there, and there must have been 150 seats, and each one looked to be about 10 feet high.
Capacity now down from 70,000 to 68,000, perhaps. So, Denver did their part, but unless the Raiders lose tomorrow to Carolina, the Broncos will be on the road, and it looks like it'll be Broncos at Baltimore, barring the fact that Denver could win the division if the Raiders lose. If the Titans win on Christmas night, they'll be home through the playoffs. Miami wins at New England, they're in. The Jets win their game at Baltimore, they're in. But if not, doors open for the Colts and the Steelers. As we say in the business, stay tuned. And, of course, we'll run it down for you on Sunday NFL Countdown. Full 2 hours. Tom Jackson, of course, with me as he's been for 14 years. He was at Mile High today. It'll be interesting to talk to him about what that scene was like. And a reminder that on Christmas night, it's Monday Night Football. Cowboys and the Titans on ABC at 9. We didn't tell you that tomorrow night we do have NFL primetime for our usual hour at 7:30 Eastern Time on Christmas Eve. Mario Lemieux back to skate with Jaromir Jagr. As the owner and the owner of so many NHL marks, you can see his re-debut against the Toronto Maple Leafs. Toronto at Pittsburgh, 7:30 on Wednesday night. Kind of a holiday treat for you. SportsCenter with Greg Gumbel and Gail Gardner following the game. We'll go through all the playoff pictures, get you set for tomorrow, and of course, look toward A Sports. Yeah, maybe Jimmy Myers will come on, too. You never know. Doug Flutie. Well, maybe he'll throw some more touchdown passes like this one to Bryson. Bills all over the Seahawks thus far, 28-14. Happy holidays.
This halftime show is presented by Hyundai. Every Hyundai is backed by America's best warranty, with 10 years powertrain coverage.
Doug Flutie on fire for Buffalo. Back with the second half after this.
Oh. And those balls. Oh. To the end zone. To Matt. Touchdown. Touchdown.
Moss. End zone. Touchdown.
We are back in beautiful Seattle, Washington for the holidays, and the Seahawks adding a memory to their already memorable season. They've given up more points in the first half tonight than they have all year long.
That's really memorable.
And those are the kind of memories that the Seahawks have had this season, courtesy of Doug Flutie,
who's just shredded them. Who's having a memorable night of his own. Three touchdown passes, 249 yards. Doug Flutie has really had himself a first half. Just done it every way possible. Nice throw to Peerless Price for a touchdown. And he scrambles out, just hangs one up in the air to Jay Riemersma. And now he does it not only with his arm, but with his legs. Breaks the tackle. And then everybody talks about Doug Flutie, a sidearm thrower. Look at the varied throws that he makes. This is a screen pass that he gets out sidearm.
Holidays.
This halftime show is presented by Hyundai. Every Hyundai is backed by America's best warranty with 10 years powertrain coverage.
Doug Flutie on fire for Buffalo. Back with the second half after this.
Oh. And those balls. Oh. To the end zone. To back. Touchdown. Touchdown.
Moss. End zone. Touchdown.
We are back in beautiful Seattle, Washington for the holidays, and the Seahawks adding a memory to their already memorable season. They've given up more points in the first half tonight than they have all year long.
That's really memorable.
And those are the kind of memories that the Seahawks have had this season, courtesy of Doug Flutie,
who's just shredded them. Who's having a memorable night of his own. Three touchdown passes, 249 yards. Doug Flutie has really had himself a first half. Just done it every way possible. Nice throw to Peerless Price for a touchdown. And he scrambles out, just hangs one up in the air to Jay Riemersma. And now he does it not only with his arm, but with his legs. Breaks the tackle. And then everybody talks about Doug Flutie, a sidearm thrower. Look at the varied throws that he makes. This is a screen pass that he gets out sidearm. This one comes over the top for the touchdown. And here he is with a little jump pass over the top. He plays the game with such variety, such adaptability, and as we talked about, he is the ultimate improviser. The way you see this pass chart, Doug Flutie, they say, can't throw the ball down the field. 6 for 8 over 15 yards. 7 for 7 under 15 yards.
Let me go back to use a word that you guys used in the open, and that's passion. He has always had a passion for the game.
He and I, we've been friends a long time, and you know, you can go up against him one-on-one in anything, and he wants to win. I will say this, the situation that he is in Buffalo is one that he does not like, but he seems a lot more tolerant of it when we talked to him yesterday than he has in the past.
Well, because of Rob Johnson's injuries, he's had more chances to play. The return by Black. Check in with Solomon Wilcots. Moments ago, he had a chance to talk to Wade Phillips.
All right, thanks, Mike. Coach Doug Flutie has nearly 250 passing yards in the first half. What convinced you that Doug could come out and be so successful passing the ball despite the poor weather conditions tonight?
Well, he threw it well last week. I mean, we played in a snowstorm last week, and he threw for over 200 yards, and I thought it was phenomenal. He just carried it into this game.
Now, special teams has been your Achilles heel all season long. They give up another big play in the first half. Why has the special teams continued to struggle?
Well, we just got a lot of young guys in there. They got to stay in their lanes. They got to get off blocks. We've had trouble with it, you know.
All right, Coach. Thanks for joining us. Let's send it back up to you, Mike.
All right. Thank you, Solomon. Flutie comes out throwing on first down to Molds, and he is out of bounds at the 33-yard line. The first half numbers take a look at Buffalo's total offense. Seattle came in with the worst defense in the league, 387.5 yards a game. The Bills already have 332 in the first half.
Mike, that's on 33 plays. That means they're averaging 10 yards a play.
And that will just get you killed. It's amazing it's only 28 points. Moles has already gone over 100 yards. 4 catches. Oh, Smith is crushed. in the backfield. Joseph came flying up. The former college quarterback in the NFL, he was a running quarterback in Cincinnati, a running back in Washington, and then he began the transformation in NFL Europe.
He just transferred himself into a linebacker. Watch this. That is a great hit. He just caught him right underneath the shoulder pads, and down went Antoine Smith.
Both Kerry Joseph and Jay Bellamy will be free agents at the end of this year as well.
Flutie trying to run for it, dives for the sticks. He's very, very close. It looked like the ball hit the 35, but it appears they're going to mark it short of that.
They're going to mark this ball on the 34-yard line and 34 and a half, and if they mark it there, Flutie doesn't get it. Flutie gets bumped. He goes back. There's excellent coverage by Seattle. Now watch when he steps up. You can check it for yourself. Look where the ball is. No, the ball is. There's where the ball is. That's a great spot.
Chad Brown manages to just catch him by the heels again.
And for the first time tonight, Chris Moore will have to come on to punt. And that's not good news for Buffalo because Charlie Rogers waits inside his 20. He's already had 171 yards returning kicks. Poor kick by Moore, short, but covered well, and Rogers only gets back to the 36. A 5-yard return after a punt of 34. We've just started the second half. The Bills lead by 14. Bills 28-14 over the Seahawks. This is Husky Stadium on campus at the University of Washington. Seattle will be playing here one more year. Then they get the new stadium, which will open in 2002. The beautiful facility, as you can tell by the computer animation. It will be an open-air stadium facing north to south, which will bring out some interesting wind patterns. The fans will be covered. The players will not. Ricky Waters uncovered across the 45. Let's go to Solomon Wilcott. Solomon?
Yeah, Mike, this is a new field turf that they have here in Husky Stadium. And, of course, Paul Allen, the owner of the team, wanting the outdoor stadium. He wants this field turf installed in the new stadium, and so does Mike Holmgren. The players really like it. It's really kind on the joints and tendon. One of the things I like, no turf burns, Mike.
And Solomon, it looks like grass. It's got a rubber base and sand at the bottom. And it seems to combine the best of artificial turf and natural grass. Well, it drains exceptionally well.
What it also has is they ground up tires, and mixed in is rubber. And there's turf on the right and field turf on the left. Draw a line down the middle, and that's what you see you got. And I love the way Chris Berman dubbed it, flubber. Flubber turf. The Boomer coming up with another name.
Haven't heard anybody complain about it at all. Just rave reviews.
There's Kent on in first down. You take, here's a close-up of it. And one thing about it is that is not green pasta for St. Patrick's Day. That's turf. But the thing about it is, in bad weather, in all of this weather, and last week it was just miserable here, they never have a problem with footing.
One other thing about the turf, each of those individual polyethylene fibers is sewn in separately, which gives it a grass-type feel.
You ought to see the guys who do the sewing.
I mean, they work forever.
Waters, nice hole. Ricky Waters. Oh, check it, it's Alexander. Pounds his way down to the 37.
You know why he's smiling? Because Sean Alexander, he only comes in on like third down and short, fourth and short. He was telling us the other day, he said, I'm used to that. But boy, do I like to carry the ball on first down. Take a look at him, protect that ball, first of all, and then the move that Sean Alexander makes to the inside. Just a great play.
First round draft choice out of Alabama, where he set all the school records there. Certainly he is the future at running back for Mike Holmgren's Seattle Seahawks. And you just know that Holmgren is going to get it done here. He is in total control of the football operation as head coach and general manager. Alexander sidesteps a couple of tacklers and maybe made it back. Oh, I'm sorry, that's Waters back in there. Maybe made it back to the line of scrimmage, and that's the extent of it.
Mike Holmgren also thought that his ball club might be able to get to 9-7 like they did a year ago. Actually, at 9-7, they won the AFC West. Felt like he might be able to sneak in the playoffs. Didn't know if he could get much more out of his ball club. Could come up, a couple games short of that.
He's very realistic about his situation. A very bright football guy, a wonderful coach. Getting a draw to water. Gary's tacklers with him inside the 35.
Ricky Waters, you know, you look at him and you see his eyes right there. Ricky Waters is one of those guys that he, honest to God, when he runs the ball or catches the ball, he believes he should score. He thinks that every play is designed for him to run for whatever yardage it is for a touchdown.
And he's grown so much as a running back. In his early in his career in San Francisco, he was so impatient, tried to bounce things outside. Now you see the great vision and the patience that every great running back has to have.
Third and six. Kittner to Dawkins to the 20, first down.
Well, there's nice a guy throw that, by Kittner.
There's a guy that just showed you some patience, John Kittner, Mike. He just waited
first
and
down,
waited.
First down.
He also had protection.
Sean Dawkins against Ken Irvin up top. He cuts him loose in the zone. And you can see the footing that the players have on this surface. Nice job coming in, making the play. Rayon Hill on the tackle.
Kittner wants the screen to Waters.
And Waters will lose a couple. Another nice job by Chris Watson, the guy they signed as a kick returner because they were struggling so much there. Then with the injury to Antoine Winfield and Donovan Greer's pressed into service as a corner and done an excellent job.
Well, you know, this guy can come up and make a play. Watch what Waters, Watson. Watson goes down underneath and forced Waters to go up in the air, but that's just an excellent tackle.
And it's hard to throw screens, I think, against the Buffalo Bills because they play a 3-4 defense. And so you've got that one additional linebacker that can get out quickly in front of your offensive lineman.
Draw play. Alexander will get inside the 20 to about the 17-yard line. And, Joe, that's talking about their linebackers. That's even with the injuries to Cowart and Rogers. And Cowart is a guy who, even though his season is over, is going to go to the Pro Bowl.
He's calling the plays again, isn't he?
Oh, yeah, Mike.
He said that part of the game he loves, Mike Holmgren, is to call the play.
I'll tell you, the guy you look for here is Daryl Jackson. I think his niftiness down towards the goal line is a big play.
Kittner lost the snap from center. There's a scramble at the 20. And the Seahawks have it back. Kittner has had fumble problems throughout his career. He is now tied for the league lead in that inglorious category. And they'll have to set up for a field goal with Lindell. Boy, Chris Gray still had it.
Kittner didn't take it.
Akili Smith and he both have 14.
Lindell will try one from 38 yards. Made 10 straight this year. Seattle, Washington State knocks it through. Seattle now down by 11. Bills lead the Seahawks 28-17, 6:46 to go third quarter. The last Monday night game of the year, Dallas at Tennessee. The Titans may need to win that ballgame to clinch home field advantage. Lindell set to kick it off after the Seahawks get a field goal off of his right foot. That's Jonathan Linton. He's back with Avion Black. Black from the 8. Cut down at the 22. We've got a timeout on the field with 6 minutes and 38 seconds to go. Third quarter from Seattle. Bills by 11. Well, when you were a kid, you probably had a train set. I did. I loved it.
Yep.
This is a nice one. Look at the buildings and the snow.
Used to make my sister put her hands on the tracks to see if I could run over a finger. That's an evil kid.
Oh, weren't you? That's
Sorry, Patty.
Flutie throws up to the 38 to Peerless Price. Ralph Wilson grabbed the headlines in Buffalo this week when he fired his general manager, John Butler. And, Paul, you have some news about it.
Well, he said there wasn't a time schedule, but there really is. Sometime this coming week, he's going to talk to 5 guys. A.J. Smith, who's in the organization. Dwight Adams, who's in the organization. Phil Savage from Baltimore, Jerry Angelo from Tampa Bay, and Tom Donahoe. I don't know who he's affiliated
with. He's affiliated with ESPN.
But Tom Donahoe is the leading candidate, actually, for that job as general manager.
Got a great career as the personnel man for the Steelers. Flutie just throwing that one away.
Think about, you know, John Butler. John Butler turned the job down because of the offer that was really made to him. And the offer was made to him was a three-year deal.
It was money, right?
Yeah, it's all money. I mean, there's just no question about it. And it was a three-year deal, and he basically turned it down. He wants a five-year deal, which he's going to get wherever he goes. And I think one other thing about it, though, in a lot of speculation is that maybe A.J. Smith gets the job. He's not going to take the job. Wherever John Butler, these guys have been friends for 20 years. Wherever John Butler lands, A.J. Smith is going to be with him.
Smith hit from behind and dropped by Anthony Simmons.
One other thing on that, Paul, I think Tom Donahoe would be an excellent choice because his family does not want to move from Pittsburgh. That was one of the things. There's been opportunities for him last year, but because of the proximity of Buffalo to Pittsburgh, he would be able to take the job and still have his family live close enough and be able to have roots there. So I would think that that would be a possibility as well.
I'll tell you, the people in Buffalo were really shocked, and so were all of the players in Buffalo. Butler got fired.
There's a speculation of where John Butler winds up, possibly with the San Diego Chargers.
Certainly wherever he goes, you know they're getting a good man because he's done a great job in Buffalo. Saluting to Price, first down. Peerless Price has made some nice catches tonight, and Flutie has been right on it.
Yeah, but what a job he does of managing the game. Watch how he takes over this offense. You know, see Jerry Ostrowski pointing. Blood says, I don't care. You just block somebody. Just get me the ball. I'll deal with it. Just total control at the line of scrimmage. Part of quarterbacking isn't just throwing and calling plays. It's managing the game, and I think that happens to be Doug Flutie's strength.
Gaping hole. Smith inside the 30. Now, we have not seen Sean Bryson in a long time. He started the ball game. We have had no report on a possible injury to Bryson, but Smith has been in there for a long time.
This is one of the problems. We talked about Cortez Kennedy earlier. Watch what Cortez Kennedy does here. He's going to take a side and just makes it a natural hole. Jerry Ostrowski, the center, number 60, just drops Cortez right down the field. Look at the natural hole. Joseph can't make the play, and Antoine Smith is in the secondary.
It looked like everybody was slanting to one side. Somebody's got to step in there, and there was nobody home. Smith again. Not as much room this time, but he picks up six. And we have just heard that Sean Bryson has an injury to his tailbone and will not come back. That's an interesting thought for Mike Holmgren, bringing Flutie to Seattle. Although Mike Holmgren, he doesn't want somebody who's going to fill in for a couple of years. He wants a guy that's going to be here for 10 years that he can ride. Smith again.
Oh, boy.
Just barreling right up the middle for another first down.
You know, we talk about the ineptness of Seattle defensively, but it isn't the effort that these guys are putting out.
That's right.
They just don't have the big people in the middle. I think the biggest loss to this defense was Sam Adams going on to Baltimore.
Well, I'm going to tell you something. Cortez Kennedy is big, and watch Jerry Ostrowski. He just takes Cortez Kennedy. Look at that. Down the line and out of the play. Look at this hole.
But he doesn't have a big guy on the other side to help him out.
Well, I'll tell you where you got a major problem is. Your problem is when you have your cornerback, Sean Springs, making the tackle 4 yards downfield. That's wrong.
Jonathan Linton will check in. And he'll get the carry. Another hole for Linton inside the 10.
Jerry Ostrowski again just opens up the hole. This guy's playing center, and he's just knocking holes in the middle of that line.
Ostrowski is one of those guys, if he gets his hands on you, he is so strong that it's over.
Jerry Ostrowski is number 60. This is center. Watch this hole open up. Here goes Ostrowski. Boom! Just blocked down in the middle. That's Cochran. Antonio Cochran, he just knocks him into the backfield.
Linton again.
inside the five, just shy of another first down. And it doesn't seem to matter who they put in there at running back. Those holes are there.
From a quarterback's perspective or a play caller's perspective, you would think now that Seattle is set up for a play action pass. But I always believe that you have to reward the offensive linemen and the backs that work so hard to get the ball down the field. You only throw in the last resort. Let the guys who have pounded it enjoy the reward of scoring.
Well, you got third and about a half a yard, not even that much.
And Antoine Smith is back in there. Flutie will keep it and has a first down.
Michael, up until that play when Flutie just ran a quarterback sneak for a yard, the Buffalo Bills rushed 24 times this ball game so far for 129 yards. That's 5.4 yards a carry, rushing the ball. Here it is, Jerry Ostrowski again, the center. They're getting excellent blocking up in the hole. Joe Panos, number 72, gets a block. First down.
And even on quarterback keepers, that defensive line is just being manhandled. First and goal for the Bills. Trying to break a four-game losing streak. Smith.
Touchdown.
Touchdown. Sheldon Jackson with the lead block. And the Bills get their fifth touchdown of the night.
The big key down around the goal line is, can your offensive linemen blow out and get underneath the defensive linemen? You see every one of Seattle's defensive linemen up in the air. And look at the drive of this offensive line. Just flat runs over Chad Brown.
Antoine Smith, 15 carries, 84 yards, two scores. And the point after makes it 35-17. The Bills on the ground with Smith in the air with Flutie, crushing Seattle. Countdown tomorrow morning. Chris Berman and the gang will have the following stories. Then at 7:30 primetime, Chris Berman and Tom Jackson back with all the highlights of the final weekend action. TJ was out for the closing of Mile High. Christie with a 15-yard kickoff this time, and the Seahawks back at the 45-yard line.
You know, I don't understand.
I don't understand at all.
Can I just say I don't either?
Well, it's unanimous, and we'll be back in a minute. Coming up next, SportsCenter, Dan Patrick and Linda Cohn standing by. The top stories: the Giants clinch home field throughout the playoffs. The finale at Mile High, and Allen Iverson with a shoulder injury. We'll have an update on that. Seattle starts with excellent field position, and Kittner throws incomplete. ESPN Saturday Night Football is brought to you by Suzuki and the innovative Quad Runner and Quad Master all-terrain vehicles. By Fred Meyer Jewelers and Littman Jewelers for all those special times. And by Intel, get the power of three, the Intel Pentium 3 processor.
Jingle bells, jingle all the way.
Oh, somebody help me.
Have you been having some tatis?
No.
Oh, Santa.
There you go, Santa.
Time winding down at the end of the third quarter. Santa Claus is just as giggly as I am. It's 35-17 Bills. One quarter to go from Seattle. Bills over the Seahawks, 15 minutes to go from Seattle. Let's take a look at the AFC playoff picture. Tennessee is already in. They will clinch the Central Division with a win. And Tennessee also gets home field with a win or a Baltimore loss. If Tennessee loses and Baltimore wins, the Ravens get home field. Oakland can clinch the West with a win. Denver is also in. Win and in, lose and need help. That's Miami. They can clinch the East with a win. The Jets need some help. If they don't win, they're 9-6. Win and need help anyway. Indianapolis and Pittsburgh, if either loses, they are gone. The NFC, the Giants are already in with home field advantage in the NFC East. Minnesota can get a first round bye if they win. New Orleans, if Minnesota loses and they win, can get a first round bye. Philadelphia's in, Tampa is in, Detroit can win and get in. St. Louis and Green Bay, they can win, but they still need help to make the playoffs in the NFC.
Nice job, Michael.
Thank you. I didn't understand any of it, but I hope you did.
That was a sweet
There's Mark.
Complete to Carsten Bailey, the second-year receiver out of Auburn, for 22 yards.
Those are the kind of routes you want to run against a 3-4 defense. You run a lot of crossing routes, especially when you lose the likes of a Sam Cowart and a Sam Rogers. Bailey just comes across. You see them run into one another. Henry Jones winds up getting bumped off. And this is an easy throw for Kitna.
It's only the fifth catch of the year for Carsten Bailey. Kitna goes down just inside the 30-yard line.
That's a sack.
Mike Holmgren with a lot of young players on this team, and they'll probably get a lot younger next year.
I like what Mike Holmgren told him. John Kitna, he says, look, don't run because there are no defensive linemen out there that you can outrun. Look at this. This is for a sack. Jay Foreman, you're going to get the easiest sack you've ever had in your lifetime.
Second and 11 for the Seahawks. Kitna on a little half roll. Complete, but not for much, to Max Strong, taken out of bounds at the 28-yard line. And Strong holding his left leg.
This is an offense that Seattle runs that really does not go down the field very much. And they don't throw the ball over 15 yards. They like a lot of crossing routes. They like to use the passing game as a supplementary part of running the football early. But it's essential that they catch the football to keep the plays alive. And especially when you got a guy like Ted Washington there, you want to get the ball off quick.
Going to his third Pro Bowl this year.
Big Ted.
But he and Pat Williams are formidable force in that middle.
I always wonder if they played side by side, like in a 4-3. That's how good the middle would be.
Well, they do on a goal line. Kitna under pressure. Ball comes loose. The Bills have it at the 30.
Marcellus Wiley comes up with it.
Flowers appeared to be the guy who knocked it loose from Kitna, and Wiley made the recovery.
Number 96 is Eric Flowers. Kitten is just trying to make something happen. They're finally getting some pressure on him. And look at this play here. That's just outstanding work by the defensive line.
Flowers, their number one pick out of Arizona State. And John Kitna. And if there's anything that Mike Holmgren doesn't like, it's a fumbler. All you need to do is talk to Amon Green, who he had, who
that's
fumbled
right,
and got rid of him.
And Kitna now leads the NFL with 15 fumbles this year. And he's just got to do a better job of protecting the ball in those situations.
Well, how about Amon Green, though? Is he doing any good? Green
Bay? Yes, he is.
I would think so. He rebounded all right.
Flutie with time to Smith. And Smith is wrapped up and knocked down by Isaiah Kazavinsky, the rookie linebacker out of Harvard. When you first hear that Isaiah Kazavinsky was a Harvard football player who graduated with honors in pre-med, what would you think? Most likely born into a well-to-do family and a life of privilege? You're not even close. He did not grow up watching the NFL on television. His family couldn't afford one, not even an old black and white, until after he left for college. Flutie on the scramble. Kazavinsky got a piece of him that time. Kazavinsky fell in love with football listening to it on the radio, and his childhood memories include his father's problems with alcohol that sometimes left him without electricity, heat, or food, and nearly cost him their home. As a star high school player, he was going through the college selection process when his mother, Margaret, was killed in an automobile accident, his guiding light. Isaiah talked to his departed mother, he said, every night, asking for advice. He visited Harvard as an afterthought and loved it. He was randomly assigned number 49, and we'll tell you about that in 1 second. Smith, monster hole up the middle for Smith. Outrunning Bellamy. Antoine Smith in a foot race lost the ball, and they have gotten it back in the end zone. The officials are staring at each other. They don't know what to call yet.
I don't believe this is going to be a touchdown. It's going to be a touchback. What an outstanding effort. Coming from behind and knocking the ball away.
Ball was fumbled into the end zone and out of
bounds. It's a touchback. Oh. First down, Seattle.
61 yards. Smith caught from behind by Paul Miranda. Buffalo is challenging the call. Antoine Smith went 59 yards, had the ball knocked away from him by Paul Miranda at the three, caught it in the end zone. The question is, did he get his feet in bounds after he got it back?
But before that, watch here at about the 10-yard line. Watch Antoine Smith, and now he's going to slow down. He's looking over his left shoulder. He's not even worried about the guys coming up behind him. Now, here's the catch. Does he have control when he goes out? He has to get both feet in. He does not.
So, it's a touchback, right?
It's a touchback.
But Miranda, what a play.
No quit. First-year player. Number 22 comes out. Now, Seattle had this happen to him last week in the Oakland game when Charles Woodson knocks the ball away from Ricky Waters. They wind up recovering in the end zone, and it becomes a safety.
It looks like he only got his left foot in.
God, that's a touchback.
And this is why coaches beg players to go to the very end. If you can catch that guy at the 1-yard line, it might turn out to be a save, and this sure did.
But I would think that every running back and every receiver in the National Football League, after we've seen it so many times, backs catch them and knock it out. Be very conscious of the ball as you get out in front and you don't see anyone in front of you. That's when you really have to be concerned, because they're going to try and punch the ball out.
Aren't there too many guys who are planning their celebration in the end zone?
Oh, yeah, and I know he was. Antoine Smith was planning a celebration. Here it goes. This is when the hit when Miranda hits the ball and it goes up in the air, and he does not have control, nor does he get both feet in bounds. But the thing about it is, all great backs, if you go to practice and watch him, all right, here comes
after
the call.
After reviewing the play, the ruling on the field stands. The second foot was out of bounds. Buffalo is charged a timeout.
All I was going to say to all great backs, even in practice, Joe, when they get through in the wide open area, they run to the goal line and make sure they hold on to the football.
Lost opportunity for Antoine Smith.
And I don't understand why Antoine Smith is laughing. I mean, to me, this is nothing. There's nothing comical about making a huge mistake in a ball game.
No, that's not really a good shot for Antoine Smith. Waters back to action up to the 25 for Seattle.
Antoine Smith showing signs of what they'd hoped for him all year long. Breaking through the line of scrimmage, outrunning backs.
Yeah, but I would be embarrassed. I wouldn't be sitting there laughing.
I agree with you there, Paul. Getting it a Waters. Ricky with a lot of running room. Got a great block downfield. And Waters forced out of bounds finally by Kerry Joseph. And Derek Mays was downfield as a wide receiver, throwing a hellacious block to give him room to run.
Ricky Waters, when he gets in the open, watch his legs. Watch the drive of this guy. Now his knees are up in the air. Watch this. He gets a great block right there by Mays, and then down the sidelines he goes.
That's a Notre Dame back and a Notre Dame receiver.
Please.
Good block. Excellent block by that young man, Derek Mays.
From Notre Dame.
From Notre Dame.
Kittner with time, complete to Fourier. Seattle trying to battle back in this one, down 35-17.
You know, John Kittner, I believe, is going to be able to play somewhere in this league. I think he's learned a lot this year. When he gets into a rhythm, he is very efficient and posts some numbers. But he's had a couple of fumbles that are just drive stoppers.
Well, in the first quarter, he had a long touchdown pass that was called back for tripping Daryl Jackson. That was about a 45 or 50 yarder.
Kittner throws complete again to Mays. The overhead shots of Seattle and the Space Needle provided by the Southwest Airlines Aerial Cam. High above Seattle, Washington, the Space Needle built for the 1962 World's Fair. And that platform is 500 feet up.
It puts on a great fireworks display when New Year's rolls in.
First and goal for the Seahawks.
Waters. Touchdown. Whoa.
Pretty good hole for Ricky Waters.
Well, you know, we are talking about the Buffalo Bills opening holes in the middle of the defensive line. This time, Ricky Waters actually could have walked in. I think it almost frightened him. Look at this. Look at the blocking. Pete Kendall, Gray. Number 62 is Gray. 66 is Kendall. And that hole is just wide open. Look at it here.
Now you know why Mike has talked about wanting to keep this young offensive line together. He feels like if Kendall does shine, they'll have an opportunity to keep him for 3 or 4 years. Antoine Smith, on the other hand, can't be very pleased.
Seattle out to go for two. Kitna from behind has to get rid of it, and it's picked off by the Seahawks. Wiley was getting pressure. Pat Williams made the interception and wanted to relive his college days and run one back. Doesn't work in the NFL. So the Seahawks still down by a dozen with 9:29 left. Finished here in Seattle. Dan Patrick and Linda Cohn will bring you SportsCenter. The Giants clinch home field advantage throughout the playoffs, the finale at Mile High, and we'll have an update on the shoulder injury to Allen Iverson, the 76ers. Lindell to kick it away. Avion Black and Linton wait deep in what is now a 12-point ball game. Linton from the 14. Has room to run up the right side. Kerry Joseph will take him out of bounds. And there's a flag down at the 35.
The flag looked like a missile. Holding.
During the return, holding 63 of the receivers. 10 yards, first down.
Bill Konaté, backup center.
Now, I think that Ricky Waters has just put on an unbelievable show. 16 runs, 69 yards, 5 for 47.
With the 49ers, he got 33 touchdowns, 32 with the Eagles. He's gotten to 25 tonight with the Seahawks in his career. The only player in NFL history to score 25 touchdowns with three different teams. He was already the only guy with more than 1,000 yards for three different teams. Next year, it might be a fourth, and he'll probably get 1,000 yards with them. Linton will be the running back for the Bills. Flutie, incomplete, intended for Reimersma, knocked away by Kazavinsky.
The one thing, there's Ricky Waters, though. The one thing about him is, you know, he's been around a long time, but nobody ever mentions him. You know, you always hear the names of all the running backs in the league, Marshall Faulk and all these guys, but his name is never brought up in all the things that he does.
Because of the record that Seattle has had this year, nobody's even talked about them on any of their pregame shows. He hasn't gotten his due recognition, and the nation gets to see him tonight.
Linton hit in the hole and dropped by Anthony Simmons.
You got to wonder, is it coincidental that Antoine Smith is sitting down and Jonathan Linton is in there?
And it's not coincidental either that the Seahawks have come alive after that play, offensively and defensively.
Let me just say one other thing about, there's Antoine Smith, about Ricky Waters, though. Every time you mention back with that, with those kind of numbers, the first thing people say, there's a Hall of Famer. You don't ever see anybody say that about
right.
him. And I'm telling you, there is a Hall of Famer.
Flutie will go to the shotgun on third and 10.
Sideline, McDaniel is wide open, totally uncovered. And goes out of bounds at the 40-yard line.
There wasn't a soul with McDaniel, and Flutie's eyes must have been the size of melons.
Did you see how quickly Doug Flutie got the snap from the center? Now he's trying to get him at the line of scrimmage. They're going hurry up. What? Look, down here at the bottom. Nobody down here. Nobody down there at the bottom. They couldn't call the timeout. Doug got the snap off.
Honest, I think it was Paul Miranda, who is a corner, was running in the middle of the field trying to call timeout, and they didn't pay any attention to him.
McDaniel was the other guy that didn't pay any attention to.
Oh, boy.
We have a good one here in Seattle. It's 35-23, artificial snow and everything.
No, it's my dandruff.
The playoffs will be settled tomorrow. But has there ever been a year where everybody who gets in the playoffs seemingly would have a legitimate shot at going to the Super Bowl?
I can't remember, but I'm just going to tell you that my choices were, way back when, Oakland and Minnesota.
That's okay. Don't gloat. Mine were Washington and Baltimore. I'm halfway there.
I had St. Louis and Tennessee. Linton swallowed up this time.
I'll tell you one thing, though. I love Christmas.
I think it's wonderful.
Well, Tennessee may be the only team that we could agree on that seems to be above the rest of the field. Everybody else seems to be right there.
You know, I think Tampa Bay has asserted themselves. I really, you know, Sean King has shown me something, but I think if Warrick Dunn remains the running back full-time for Tampa, they become a legitimate threat because of the explosiveness of that offense with him back there.
Flutie drops straight back under pressure. Throws, Price, got it! Had two shots at it and made the second one.
You know, I'm going to tell you what, the Buffalo Bills on offense between Eric Moles and Peerless Price, they have a highlight film that they can use for the rest of their lives.
What you're talking about is you're not talking about plays that are drawn up. You're talking about players making plays. Again, excellent coverage against Peerless Price. Ike Charlton's all over him, but Price just makes the play.
Price, look at eight this catches, 132 yards. He and Moles have really put on a display.
Well, you're looking at a guy with total concentration on the football, and that's what it takes to make plays like that.
Antoine Smith is the tailback. First and goal, Smith. Touchdown.
Now you can smile.
He didn't stop on that one.
Talk about a guy having a day. Antoine Smith, close to 150 yards.
You know, we've talked about this guy all night long, Jerry Ostrowski, number 60 to center. Look at this blocking down on Cortez Kennedy. Just knocks him out of the hole.
A career high for Antoine Smith, 147 yards. And the Bills up 41-23, another touchdown for Smith. Buffalo now up 42-23. Doug Flutie tonight has a perfect quarterback rating. 158.3 is as high as the scale goes. 20 of 25, 366 yards, three touchdowns, and another squib kick, which is just not understandable. It allows Seattle to come back to the 50-yard line for field position again.
Well,
that's staggering.
There's a reason they're doing that, Michael, because they're last in kickoff return average. So this way it cuts it down.
They're last at everything,
though. I'll never understand.
How about they're just bad?
It.
Is that a good way of describing it? I mean, you know, Ronnie Jones has basically just given up on his team's ability to cover kicks.
Well, when you squib kicking in the middle of a game, I mean, what are you saying to the other team? Here you go at midfield. Kittner with good protection. Throws underneath the Waters. Ricky Waters now dives toward the 30.
Let me tell you, two offensive linemen downfield.
The problem you have is when you have a screen called, you're asking your lineman to go downfield, and then you throw the ball downfield, you're automatically going to get a penalty.
Number 66, offense, illegally downfield. 5 yards, repeat first down.
You hear coaches talk about short fields all the time, how much easier it is to score from a short field. The Seahawks have started on the average from their own 42-yard line. That is a short field, and they have six touchdowns.
And it's a disservice to your defense. You just don't give them a chance to play, you know, football. Everybody says, well, if we can get them to go 75, 80 yards, that's not the case.
Under pressure and just crushed by Newman. Keith Newman blasted it. The seventh sack of the year for the second-year linebacker from North Carolina.
Kettner never saw this coming. And Keith Newman, number 53, watch him launch himself and bang. And he did not hit him in the head. He hit him right in the shoulder with his shoulder pad.
I had nowhere to go behind him because Sean Price was right there.
Second and 19, time a factor of course, 5:42 and counting. Kettner, short set, throws, Bailey. Across midfield to the 47. If Seattle doesn't make a miracle comeback, they will finish at 6-10. And Mike Holmgren will go on with his plans in the offseason for acquiring a quarterback. And Mike, figuring out his salary cap problems and the rest of it.
And Michael, Mike Holmgren has really got is finding a balance between being the coach and the GM and all the other responsibilities he has.
Getting a scrambling, doesn't slide, stays on his feet, and is down to the 33.
We talk about this style of offense that Kitten is. Take a look at that. Only one pass thrown down the field over 15 yards. This offense put so much pressure on the receivers and the backs never to drop a ball that it makes it very difficult to, I think, score points in bunches. You need to have some kind of big plays in your offense. And I don't think you're taking advantage of the interference rule that exists today.
Kitna goes deep this time and missed a wide open to Tula Mealy. And I'm saying wide open.
Yeah, but there's a reason why that he was wide open and he wasn't able to get him the ball. You're going to get a chance to see the route. Then you're going to get a chance to see why. He releases down the field. They have nobody in coverage. Now, you'd think that's an easy pass, right? It is if somebody's not in your face. Kitna tries to step up, and Newman just levels him.
Apparently, the defense is not used to a tool of Mealy going out on pass patterns because they didn't even wave bye-bye when he went past. Draw play to Waters, and he's eaten up. That time it was Holosek.
They're just tired of Kitna standing back there, so they're sending their linebackers, and they're just teeing off. And this is a great blitz against a draw. And Holosek did exactly what you're supposed to do. Teddy Cottrell, the defensive coordinator, he loves it. Is go to it at the back through to the quarterback.
Defensive coordinators in this league get a lot of credit. You know, Marvin Lewis in Baltimore, head coach candidate, certainly John Fox in New York. Ted Cottrell also should be mentioned with those other two men.
He really deserves a shot. Kitna trying to keep the drive alive. Look out from behind. Newman again. The ball is loose and the Bills have it. Picked up by Porter. Darryl Porter forced out by Kitna. Another fumble by the Seattle quarterback. His third of the night. He leads the NFL in that department.
He's running away with it.
Newman having a hellacious series.
Well, John Kitna on this play was trying to step up and make something happen. He knew he had third and long yardage. He had to get the ball down the field. But watch him. When he's stepping up, he's not paying attention. And right from the backside, number 53, Newman knocks the ball out.
But I think he waits too long to go. If you wait and hesitate that long to take off, the defenders are going to close on you. The linebackers are going to catch you.
Buffalo Bills have already racked up 566 yards in total offense. Their franchise record is 582. They have just used the Seattle defense. Jonathan Lint. Another big hole. Two other quarterbacks have had a game with perfect quarterback ratings. Kurt Warner this year. Kurt Warner did it for the St. Louis Rams, and Peyton Manning did it for the Indianapolis Colts. And Flutie may not throw again.
I don't think he's aware of it.
I don't think he really cares about it either.
I think.
Somebody, Well, I've always despised that rating system anyhow. Think if Doug Flutie throws a 35-yard touchdown pass here, his rating wouldn't go up because there's an upper limit on it.
Well,
what point is that?
I'm not big on ratings per game, per quarter. I think at the end of the year, you know, you rate how they did. To me, it's a lot of different things that go into it. And what we're seeing here again is Doug Flutie's ability to manage a game. That time he snapped the ball with just 1 second to go. Now he'll let this one go to the 2-minute warning.
Bills will face third and four at that point, but the clock is the real enemy of the Seattle Seahawks. They're down by 19. We have reached the 2-minute warning in the final game of the season for both of these teams. Center coming up when we're finished here in Seattle. Dan Patrick and Linda Cohn will come by, and the Giants clinch home field advantage throughout the playoffs today. The last game at Mile High, quite a celebration. Elway was back, our Tom Jackson was back there, and an update on Allen Iverson and his shoulder injury.
Let heaven and nature sing. Let heaven.
Well, you really don't have any.
I love Christmas. I love Christmas.
No pride whatsoever. Linton dragging tacklers with him for a first down. ESPN Saturday Night Football brought to you by GMC. For professional grade people come professional grade trucks. By Timex with ridiculously easy eye control setting systems. By Touchstone Pictures, Double Take starts Friday, January 12th. And by Dell, providing the infrastructure to power your e-business. The Harry Simeon Corral with me tonight. Linton. Down to the 25. Thanks to Southwest Airlines for all their support this year.
Chad Brown strips this away. The whistle had not blown. And the referee
is Seattle's football. Was he down or not? The referee's still talking about it.
Now he was in a pile. Watch. He's not really down. No, they're holding him up. Oh, I'm sorry. His left knee looks like it's down. It looks like it's down. I don't know. If you're Buffalo, do you take the time to review it?
Well, it's inside two minutes, so it's up to the official.
Or does the official take time to review it?
You know the sad part about it?
He should.
They were 1 yard of tying the franchise, the Bills franchise record for one game, 582 yards.
But this is where the official should review it. I don't care what the score is. They should take a look at that.
Instead, Kitna will fumble again. He gets this one back. Been a horrible problem for John Kitna. Life Larson knocked it away from him.
Kitna for Christmas, they're going to give him a football with a handle on it. A real big handle.
The real oddity for Seattle is that both their quarterbacks, John Kitna and Brock Heward, are hometown guys who lived their entire life dreaming of playing quarterback for the Seattle Seahawks. This one's batted up in the air and intercepted by the Bills. Eric Flowers, the rookie defensive end. So Kitna didn't fumble it this time, but he threw it into the hands of a defensive lineman who picked it.
Well, we've talked about the night that Doug Flutie has had. Eric Flowers has forced a fumble. Here he just swats the ball in the air with his right hand and makes the interception.
These overhead shots provided by the Southwest Airlines aerial cam, and they are above the Seattle Space Needle right now. Thanks for being with us all season long on ESPN.
Couple yards here, Paul, right? That's what we're looking for.
Well, they're going to take a knee. They're not going to give. Well, they don't know, and
This will be the last game that we will have the honor and privilege of working with our director, Mark Payton. He is moving on to better things in his life with he and his wife, Darla. And we can't express in words what a good friend he has been, but we can tell you about his ability as a director. He is absolutely the best.
And for all these years, everyone has witnessed his ability to be able to show you football at its best. And
we're going to miss you a lot, buddy.
Mark Payton has been he's been such a close friend of mine for a lot of years when I first started at ESPN years and years and years ago, and I have not met a finer man than Mark Payton.
And everybody that's worked with us on the crew this year, a terrific job as usual in all kinds of elements. And we're lucky to have everybody as a part of what we do here.
Absolutely, Joe. We have a very dedicated group of people who have worked very hard all year long. We thank them so much. That's
Merry
it
Christmas,
from Seattle.
Everybody.
The final score, the Bills 42, the Seahawks 23. SportsCenter is next with all the news, scores, and highlights. For Joe Theismann, Paul McGuire, Solomon Wilcutts, and our entire hardworking crew, this is Mike Patrick. This has been a presentation of ESPN, the worldwide leader in sports.
ESPN, thank you for watching this presentation of the National Football League.